Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Well, happy late Independence Day. I think it's something to remember today. I'm thankful for our independence, that we, the freedoms that we still have. Thankful to our Lord, the God Almighty, that allows us that freedom. Why don't you stand and let's open up with this familiar hymn.
King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise Him, for He is our health and salvation. All ye who hear now to His temple draw near, praise Him, bread and oration. So wondrously reigneth, shelters thee under His wings, yes, so greatly sustaineth. Hast thou not seen how thy desire hath been granted in what He ordained? Prosper thy work and defend thee. Surely His goodness and mercy here daily attend thee. Oh, ponder anew what the Almighty can do, if with His love we befriend. King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise Him, for He is thy health and salvation. All ye who hear now to His temple draw near, praise Him in glad adoration.
Amen.
Church. Today's a big day. Anybody tired? If you're a guest with us, I just want to say thank you for being here. It's all right. He was answering that question. He's tired. I want to thank you for being here. You add to our worship this morning. But for you that are here and for our church family, we'd like to know what's going on in your life. I'd like to be praying for you. I prayed for many of you this morning already, but we have a connect card in there. Let me know how I can be praying with you in what's going on in your life. But I'm going to share. I'm just going to say there is a heaviness of spirit this morning. And I hope that you are in tune. If you're not in tune to it, let us pray as we go through. But there are so many of our church family that are dealing with big things right now. And a lot of struggles and a lot of how is God going to answer and what's going to happen. I don't think today is the warm, fuzzy, feel-good message. But I absolutely know that God has a message to speak to you. And so whatever it is that you're going through, whatever it is that is a struggle for you right now, we're going to partake at the end of our service of the Lord's meal. It's a unity meal. It's a meal of how we deal with one another. It's a meal of how we deal with ourselves and the Lord. And so there's a weightiness today. So I want to pray for us. And I'm just going to ask you, we're going to have just a minute of quiet. I want to make sure that you've had time to deal with the Lord. And if you need to deal with one another, care more about what God thinks than what anybody else thinks. If you have to get up and go across the room and talk to someone and make sure that we're in unity, that absolutely makes God smile. His word is very clear. But whatever it is you're struggling with, whatever it is that's weighing on your heart, whether it be sin or consequences of others' sin, whatever it might be, I just invite you to press into the Lord. See, if you don't know Jesus, you have no answer for any of this. But if you do know Jesus, then the answer is to let him be God and to direct your steps. And that's only going to be found by sitting with him and pressing in. So I want to invite you to just pray. I'm going to just have a moment of quiet, and then I'm going to voice a prayer for all of us. Let's bow our hearts. Father, your people have a desperate need for you. God, they are sinful and broken. They are weary and anxious. And in you, all things are good and right. Father, think about the messages that you've given us over the last many weeks and how easy it is to be anxious because we look at the circumstances around us and forget that you are the God of the wind and the waves. No storm comes upon us except that which you've allowed. Or even that which you caused. And knowing that all the storms in our life are meant to make us holy. God, certainly they don't make us happy a lot of times. So this morning, we know that we're going to eat at your banqueting table. And we're going to declare to the world that you are God and you are in control. That you are faithful and you are coming back. But even in our hearts, it's hard sometimes for us to rest in that. So I pray that today we do find our rest in you. For those who do not know you as Lord and Savior, that today they will find rest in you, that today will be the day of salvation. God, for each of us as we struggle with sin and the consequences of sin, whether it be our own or those around us, speak to us. Give us our marching orders. And let us be a people that will truly love and honor and fear you. God, teach us what it truly means to be a disciple. As we sing, don't let us go through the motions. I pray that if it is going through the motions, that you'll even just quiet us and sit us down. But from the overflow of our heart, that you are good and worthy of our song, worthy of our praise, even that which we bring, may it be pleasing aroma to you. Bless us for your name's sake, we pray. Amen.
I'd invite you to stand with me if you would. Let's continue to worship our Lord using our voices. Thank you. Heavenly Father, Lord, there's so much truth in that. I thank you that we come before the Almighty God, who is our provider. He is the one who provides the spirit, the spiritual food that we need. What's missing in our lives without that is what we need, and that's through Christ. Thank you, Father, that we come before you this very morning, knowing that you are our sustainer and that we can trust in you for all things. I pray a special blessing on each person that's in this room this morning.
Yeah.
That you speak to your children in a mighty way as your word is proclaimed. Thank you for allowing us into your presence. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, amen, amen. Thank you. I think that song is the heartbeat of so many of our church, but it needs to be the heartbeat of everyone here. That God be so necessary in your life that you're desperate for him at every moment. And the American way is for us to try to order our life in such a way that we don't need God. So where you're desperate for him, understand that is truly the best place that you can be. You are a guest with us, and you've not been here as we're walking through the book of John. I want to just share with you and remind us all that as we looked last week, we saw the recorded events that happened after the miraculous meal, after the feeding of the 5,000 men. And what we learned was that many who had participated began to search for the one who fed them. But the question that we then had to wrestle with is, what exactly are they looking for? And many are looking for a king. They're looking for a savior. They were looking for an entertainer. They were looking for a comfort maker. They were looking for a momentary needs solver. And then when the crowd found Jesus, they were faced with a very real question. What does it mean to be a disciple? What does it mean to follow Jesus? And today we continue this encounter with Jesus and those who are seeking to find, or to find out, and what they do find out is more than they bargained for. And this is the beginning of a three-week series as we look through what Jesus' claim is, that he is the bread of life. And today we're going to focus on the true bread. And those listening, they're going to respond with a bad faith question in response to Jesus' declaration. And the kindness of our God is that his response to their bad faith question is going to be to give a good faith answer. But what that turns out to mean is that those who are looking for an entertainer, those who are looking for a physical needs provider, a rescuer, they're going to begin to turn away from Jesus, and it's a true faith rejection. And so I invite you to read with me. We're going to read John chapter 6, verses 30 through 50 this morning. John chapter 6, beginning in verse 30. So they said to him, "Then what sign do you do that we may see and believe in you? What work will you perform? Our fathers ate manna in the wilderness, as it is written. He gave them bread to eat from heaven." And Jesus said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, it was not Moses who gave the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." And they said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." And Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. And whoever comes to me shall no longer hunger. And whoever believes in me shall never thirst. But I said to you that you have seen me and yet do not believe. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me I will never cast out. For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but to the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day. For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. So the Jews grumbled about him, because he said, I am the bread that came down from heaven. And they said, is this not Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How does he now say, I have come from heaven? And Jesus answered them, do not grumble amongst yourselves. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day. It is written in the prophets, and they will all be taught by God. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father except for the one who is from God. He has seen the Father. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate manna in the wilderness, and they died. This is the bread that comes down from heaven, so that one may eat of it and not die. Let's bow our hearts before God. Father in heaven, I am mindful just looking at these 21 verses, how much you've repeated yourself. Looking at just the idea of a conversation between our Lord Jesus and those he came to save. And how repetitive was the answer to their questions as they tried to look from a different direction. And I think about my own life and a life of the American Christian. And God, I'm mindful that I want what I want, and I want it in a way that I want it. I'm mindful that I'm looking for a wide and smooth road, a road without difficulty. But that would be contrary to your word, for you said that that road leads to destruction. And so then when I find out that your road is narrow and filled with difficulties, speed bumps and potholes, broken tree limbs, others who have abandoned the race and left their vehicle in the road, some that are not moving as fast as I would like them to move, and they inhibit me. God, all of these things I am mindful of this morning, because it's those things that are being used by you to conform me into the image of my Savior. And it is true for all of us. And so where we find ourselves in those difficult times, I pray that you'll answer, this is what it means to be a disciple. That you are desiring to put to death in us sin and let righteousness reign, and that cannot come except through trials by fire. So where your people are in the fire right now, I pray that you will be with them, that no flame, no heat, no smoke will get upon them, that they will trust in you and in you alone, for they will be able to say, my God can deliver me, but even if he doesn't, I will bow to no one else. God, there are many here today who certainly do not know the Lord Jesus as Savior, as King. I pray today that you will break their hearts by letting them hear the truth one more time, and that they will say yes. God, where you let sin be aware in our life, that we will be eager to repent. You will conform us into the image of our Savior. Bless us, God, as we look into your word and understand it. Help our hearts to be ready to hear and to respond. We ask it in the name of Christ Jesus, who is our Lord and Savior. Amen. So in verses 30 through 34, we're going to begin with a bad faith question. And this is the group Now, Jesus had just told them, as we look, he says, well, what do we have to do to get this eternal life that you're talking about? That's what they had asked him. And he said to them that the work that they needed to do was to believe in him. Believe in him, in Jesus, for salvation. And then they respond, and I would have liked to even have known the tone of how they responded. I wish that we could know that here. And, well, what are you going to do? How are you going to prove that you are who you say you are? What proof will you show us? Now think about that for just a minute. Like, it seems like a logical question, except for what have they just seen? Where did they just come from? They came from seeing 5,000 men, some 12,000 people fed with a child's lunch. They saw the only boat that could escape a storm that put every professional fisherman in the area. And they saw Jesus somewhere that he could not have been. You don't even want to ask that question of how you got here, so they kind of danced around it. All of this has happened within 24 hours. And they say, well, prove it. After all you've seen, you're still asking for more. And then, if that wasn't enough, I got up this morning and looked in the mirror. How often do we say to God, prove it? I know you've been faithful for 30 years, but can I trust you in this? Can I trust you to, what are you going to do to prove it? How are you going to let my heart rest in you today? Because this new thing that's going on, I don't know how to handle it. So as much as I want to be snarky at this group, I find that I would have been in this group. And they put all of their effort. Look at, I mean, what they did. They got in they said, he's not here. Where'd he go? They put all their effort into the travel. They put all their effort into the search. They put all their effort in finding Jesus. But what we're going to find out as we get to verse 58 is that who kind of snuck in their group that's looking for Jesus, this is the Pharisees and the scribes. Oh, that can't be that guy. He's crazy. Doubt gets introduced into the group that's chasing after this man, Jesus. And doubt, having been sown in the hearts, is the playground for the devil. And he goes to work. And he goes to work big time. And what I would have us to see as those who believe on the Lord Jesus is that we look for comfort in the uncertain things in our life. And the people that we look for that comfort from have an enormous sway over us and how we're going to handle things. You're going through a hard time, you'll tend to try to find people who will sympathize with you, who will tell you what you need to know, who will speak words of comfort, but not necessarily words that you need to hear. Some might speak downright lies. See, these scribes and these Pharisees, they don't believe that Jesus is anyone. They have rejected it and they have gone after him. They have come after him with a fierce vengeance. And they infiltrate a group that was just 24 hours ago ready to force Jesus to become their king. Think about that. Just think about that for a minute. Yesterday, about this time, we were going to by force take you and make you leader of us. Now we've chased you down, and some people have gotten in our group. They've begun to speak words that make us think twice. Why don't you do it again? Why don't you just prove one more time that you are who you say you are? And so my question for you as you want to wrestle today, as you leave here and you think about your life and what's going on, is who's influencing you into what you do and what you believe? Who has your ear? And this is proof that they want another free meal. Well, God provided manna in the wilderness. Show us if we are to believe who you are. Are you as great as Moses who fed our forefathers? They literally just saw that, not 24 hours ago. And in less than 24 hours, they deny his power and his authority. How long does it take you and I before the circumstances have us deny his power and authority? And then, if the bad faith question wasn't enough, they even attempt to use scripture to justify themselves. Well, let me quote the Bible to you, Jesus, and let me tell you what God said. You know, you and I can make the Bible say anything we want. You take it out of context and you twist it enough, you can find anything that you need. I have lots of examples. I don't think you need any examples. You know where you've done it. I know where I have done it. And how easy it is for us to twist the scriptures so that we can feel justified in ourselves. And Jesus' response, truly, look, bottom line, fact of the matter is, he says, it wasn't Moses. And this is misuse of scripture is pointing to their misunderstanding and their false hope. Moses did never feed them. It was God. God is the provider. God is the Savior. But the manna that he had given was just a foreshadowing of what was to come. The real life-sustaining food is not what we put in our bellies, but God himself. What will fill their souls is to eat that which comes from heaven. So Jesus' answer to them, if we're going to put it in modern translation, is, you ask me what else? What more will I do for you? Let me have you to understand that this is the work that the Father has given me, that I, the messenger of God, give you the message of God, which is the offer of eternal salvation. But eternal salvation is only found in the name of Jesus. And this is the spiritual bread that you must feast on if you're going to have life. Well, and then their response, well, sir, give us this bread always then. They still don't even know what they're saying. Well, we want to eat, we want a ticket to the buffet every day. They still don't get it. They want the performance, they want the show, they want the free meal, they want the filled belly. I'll eat any dinner you make, just as long as you make it for me. But, on the other hand, it needs to be the way I like it, when I like it, and what I like. And then here's the hardest part, if I just say it out loud. Jesus won't give them what they want, so they won't take what he gives. Ask that about yourself. Don't just jump through the hoops. Ask it about yourself. If God won't give me what I want and the way I want it, then I don't want anything. It's a hard truth. What if he gives me what I need, but it's not what I want? Do I receive it? They speak this from a bad faith answer. Bad faith question, and Jesus is going to give a good faith answer. He says, well, let me tell you, I am the bread of life, and whoever comes to me will never hunger, never thirst. And in this, at verse 35, is a very, very gentle call. Stop worrying about your rent. Stop worrying about your job. Don't worry about what's for lunch today. Your heart is so focused on the right now that you're missing all the point. Don't be focused on the temporal when the eternal is not taken care of. You keep asking about your belly. And I want you to know that I could feed you. But at this point, you're going to end up in hell, forever separated from the God that loves you. Or you can seek first the kingdom of God, and He'll take care of you forever. If you can't pay your light bill, that's a hard, hard truth. But Jesus is telling us, because this isn't anything new. It's what's always been. And John's going to write for us seven different statements that we call the I am statement. They're declarations of Jesus. And he's going to say here, I am the bread of life. This is the first one that he writes. I, Jesus says, am the one that truly sustains a person. Jesus says he's the bread of life, and all men are invited to come to him, invited to believe on him. In this illustration, to feed on him. Jesus explained that one who comes to him, that is to receive him or believe upon him, we'll find a spiritual hunger that is satisfied only in Jesus. But I said that you have seen me, he says, and yet you don't believe. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me I will never cast out. For I have come down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of he who sent me. Now here the language is not soft, it's much more pointed. We can almost imagine a finger in our chest as he would say this. You refuse to let your hearts hear the truth, and you refuse to let it sink in. And so he makes very clear that coming to him is the work of the Father. You see, we've taken that for granted because we are on this side of the cross, and it's just been ingrained in who we are. But it was a big wrestle. Why should they trust this, and why should you trust it? Because only one has come from heaven, and that's Jesus. By the way, you're not going to be willing to listen to him. But the other reason you should believe this is because only one is returning to heaven, and that's Jesus. And it's because he is God. And so in verse 39, we get there, and he says that he, as he continues to speak to their hearts, he would say, I want to add, I hope you hear me, people. Listen. Know the truth. I don't stand here to gain a following. By the way, in case you're thinking that's why I'm here, remember 24 hours ago you wanted to make me king? 24 hours ago, you wanted to make me king by force. I wasn't ever looking for a following from you that would make something out of me. I've already rejected that. I am standing here, Jesus says, to tell you the very will of the Father. And the Father's will is that everyone should believe in Jesus and be reconciled to God and to worship him forever. What are they focused on? Lunch. I don't know how many people want me to hurry up and finish preaching so they can go eat. I have things to do. What you have to hope in is so much greater than your belly being filled right now. Much more than the circumstances that you're dealing with now. You have the gift of forever with the God of all creation. Don't worry about lunch today, what you'll eat. Where will you spend eternity? Who is your God? Is it the one true living Almighty God who you have seen in the person of Jesus, or is it you? Well, I don't think myself as God. You're the decider of all rules. You're the decider of where you'll spend your time and what you'll do, where you'll go, what's acceptable, what's not acceptable, whom you will serve, how you will receive all that you will receive. We all serve something. Every one of us will serve a master. Is it the one true and living God, or is it something in this world? And that's what they were chasing. Those who had infiltrated them had all sorts of reasons. Position and power, authority, status. They didn't want to lose it, so they swayed everybody to stop following God, to stop seeking Him. And in verses 41 through 50, we see a true faith rejection. In verse 41, he says, this is the part of the result of that negative influence. This is a result of denying all of what they've just seen, all of what they've just experienced for themselves. And they do so because Jesus won't give them what they want, when they want it, and how they want it. It says that they grumble. Well, he can't be who he claims to be. You can just imagine those who have infiltrated, right? What do you mean he can't be who he says he is? What are you talking about? Well, I don't know. Just imagine the wrestle that's going on in there. Because they're not at this point speaking to Jesus. They're at this point arguing with one another. And they're talking. But what they're going to say is, I'll have you pay attention to this, is no one is saying in this argument, well, the scriptures don't point to him. Well, I know that there's supposed to be an Elijah that was to come, and everybody thinks that was John the Baptist, but that means Jesus is somewhere else, but it can't be this guy. Well, it's not because he just fed 5,000 people or 5,000 men or some 12 to 15,000 people. Can't be because people who were blind are now seeing. None of these things, it's not that. No, he can't be who he said he was because we know his parents. You will deny every bit of evidence for the easiest thing. I mean, how's John the Baptist the Elijah that was to come? They didn't have any problem believing that. They were so afraid that he is exactly who he said he was that they weren't even going to go after him. The only one that could even touch John the Baptizer was Herod. Everybody else, all of these religious people, were sure that he was exactly who he said he was, and everybody knew his parents. No, it's not that the scriptures point to Jesus. It's not that the signs point to Jesus. It's not the claims of Jesus. It's we know Joseph. Therefore, we can't believe. Okay, bud. Verse 43 says that Jesus responded by saying, don't fight amongst yourselves. It's not that. It's really unless the Father who sent me draws you. I got to tell you, and what's going to happen to you, and this is the promise. This is that stuff that we just read over without paying attention. It's stuff that's become so familiar to us. And he says, the one who does, I'm going to raise him up on the last day. He knows their hearts. He knows the response that's going on. He says, don't moan. Don't complain. These words are offensive. Just for the record, he isn't done being offensive. He's going to ramp it up next week and the week after. You view the words that I come from heaven because you know my mom and my dad here? They don't understand how God has worked. You think that's impossible? The work that God is doing, the Father himself is bringing people to follow and to believe in Jesus. Y'all, that's a miracle. To lay down our own selves to pick up a Savior and to believe is a miracle, and you're worried about a lineage. But I'll tell you what, in the last day, everything that you have gone through because you have followed Jesus, because you've done it His way and not your own way, it's going to be worth it. Because in the last day, He will raise you to eternal life. And this is eternal life. You get to spend forever with the God of all creation. And there's a real choice that has to be made, because if you believe in faith in Jesus, if you're willing to let Him conform you into His image and let yourself die so that you can be raised up into the image of Christ, then you get God for all eternity. And it doesn't matter where it is. People worry about what's heaven going to look like and what's it going to be and what am I going to do and forever seems like a long time. None of that matters. What matters is that you get to be where you are with the God of all creation, and He is welcoming you in and saying, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." For some of you, that's my boy. That's my girl. In the face of everything, that you stand for Jesus because you believe in Him. That's my girl. It's my boy. But what is the real reality is in the other hand. Are all those who are saying, "I don't want you. I don't care what you've offered. I know what's best." And they get exactly what they want. See, Jesus doesn't send anybody to hell. They ask for it. And what we've messed up in this world is some idea that you have a ticket that gets you out of hell as fire insurance. See, but why that's messed up is because what makes heaven heaven is Jesus is there. And He will make no one love Him that doesn't want Him. So if you don't want Him because you want self, He allows you to choose that. But the real reality is at the end, you're going to spend an eternity separated from the God that created you. And it will be hell. And yes, there is a weeping and a gnashing of teeth because it's bad. Yes, there are flames. Yes, there's an unquenchable fire. But all that you're going to hear forever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever are the opportunities that Jesus set before you to say, "Come to me, you who are weak and heavy burdened, and I will give you rest for your soul." And you screamed, "I reject you." There set before us a real choice. But if you choose Jesus, then again you have to wrestle with, what does it mean to be His disciple? Does He really have all of you? Does He have your heart? Or do you tell Him all the ways that you're going to do things and all of the rules that you're going to set out and expect that He's going to follow you? That's not lordship, and that's not a disciple. You remember that Nicodemus had told us, as we go back to chapter 3, that they believed that the Jews were chosen by God based on the covenant with Abraham. And Jesus makes it clear that God has to draw them, that anyone responds to Him must respond to Him through the person of Jesus. There is no other way, for there is no other name under heaven given to men by which you must be saved. People to this day reject God. And they do so because they want to be in control. They want to feel as if they're leading the relationship with God. And Jesus says, "The Father calls and we come." And this is a hard truth. And from the very beginning, people don't like God's terms. But it shows us is that God's initiative is salvation. God is drawing people. But it's also why the scriptures tell us that the fields are white unto harvest, because that is the work of the Father, is to draw all men into relationship with Jesus. What then is our response is to join him in his work. And then I will just tell you, disciple, as you want to make notes and wrestle with what it means getting in the game. It means serving and being a part of things. It means that you don't want people to die and go to hell, so what part can I play? And we don't all have the same gifts and talents. But all of our gifts and talents are meant for that end. Not only am I conformed into the image of Jesus, but all of those around me, that they too might be conformed into the image of Jesus. So how would I know if God is drawing me? You're here. And you're listening. How did you get here today? Some of you know that you didn't want to be here today, but God wanted you here because he wants you to hear that he loves you. And right now, you love you more than you love anything else, and you love your sin more than anything else. And because you love you and your sin more than anything else, you're going to have a bill at the end of this life that you can't pay. And that real hell awaits. But the offer is laid before you. Will you believe? Will you repent? Will you receive the offer of forgiveness, the salvation that is found in Jesus Christ? And there's an event that is happening right here as God is making himself very known. I believe it's the second time that we see this taking place. The one that we know about is in Luke chapter 4. So in Luke chapter 4, verse 18 through 21, I'll read to you and just remind your hearts. It says that Jesus, being in the synagogue, they have asked him to stand up and teach, and he opens a scroll and reads, and he says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim the good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and the recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And then Jesus rolls up the scroll and he gives it back to the attendant and he sits down. And the eyes of all the synagogue were fixed on Jesus. And he said to them, "Today, the scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." With that as our backdrop, what happens here, as he says, "Everyone who has heard and learned from God comes to me." It's Isaiah 54:13. Looks like one more time that the scripture of the day was given to Jesus as he walks into the synagogue. It says that God's people will be taught by God himself. And you can hear Jesus say, "Today this has been fulfilled in your hearing." For God himself is instructing his people. Those who are not his will reject it. Those who are his will press in, and we won't see that for two more weeks. You wonder, if you were just to be fair and to sit down and think, how should they respond to hearing this? It makes me think, how would I have responded? And then the deeper question for me is, how am I responding? That God will instruct his people himself. Those who belong to God are taught by God. They're being drawn by God. Therefore, everyone who has heard and learned from the Father will come to Jesus. And he says, Jesus is saying to those who are in the crowd, those who do not believe, says, "You are untaught by the Father. You are unlearned in the scripture, and you have no heart for the God that you claim. And thus, you can't see and believe in Jesus." I can't tell you the number of people that I've talked to in my lifetime who tell me that I worship some sky god and that there can't be a real God. And I ask them what they know about the scriptures and they say nothing. What are they rejecting? They're rejecting the fact that anyone or anything can be God over them. But then I ask church people, how many of you have read the scriptures? And they look at me with blank stares. What God do you serve? And if we serve the God of our own imagination, we don't serve the one true and living God. So if you belong to Him and you say, well, what is a disciple? A disciple is going to read the Word because reading the Word is spending time with God. John chapter 1 has already taught us that. And if you're not spending time with the Word, you can tell me every excuse and I will listen and I will say, well, God bless you. But it does not matter what I say. If you don't want to spend time with Jesus now, what makes you think you want to spend an eternity with Him? And yes, it's a hard truth, but one that is better for us to wrestle on this side of judgment. Verse 47, he says, truly I say to you that whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. And yes, your fathers ate manna, but understand this, they died. The bread that comes from heaven, so that one may eat and not die, that's me, Jesus says. Faith in Jesus alone is the answer to sin and death. There is no other way. Yes, bread is necessary for our physical constitution. But Jesus is necessary for eternal life. Now, before I just make that and move on, understand this. Every person in here has eternal life. Where and with whom you spend it is the question. You can reject that I'm laying this out before you, and one day you're going to see it. But I invite you to wrestle with it now, because when your life is required, it will be too late. And you will see that there is a real eternity and there is a real consequence. Will you pay your consequence, or will Jesus pay your consequence? See, every person's going to feed on something. And you look at your own life. Are you feeding on amusement? Are you feeding on entertainment? Maybe business or knowledge? Or power? Maybe you feed on fear or anxiety. The problem is when we feed on any of these things, and you might even have your own list, that it will leave you and everyone you infect starving and malnourished. See, sin never affects one person. The sin that is in you affects your family. It affects the small group around you. Listen to me. It affects your church. It affects the family of believers. And it infects those who don't believe. Because when you wear the logo of Jesus Christ on your body and then live like He's not yours, the rest of the world rejects the image of Christ that you display. Our sin is a big deal. The greatest lie that the devil has put upon us as the church is that grace is so free and easy, just live any way you want. And so I ask you, is that a disciple? The forefathers, the Israelites, they fed on the manna in the wilderness. But they all died. And the bread of Jesus, the spiritual bread, is greater than the manna that Israel ate, because God brought it down from heaven. God now came down from heaven. It's a different meal. They wanted to have their bellies full. Jesus wanted to take care of their eternity. And when you partake of Jesus, and that means to have faith in Him, to trust in Him. He changes everything. From that moment all the way through eternity. But what He does not do, what Jesus does not do, though He changes everything, is it does not mean He takes the consequences away. See, what is, I think, the hardest thing for us to deal with is that God allows what He allows because through it, He is working in all of these other areas. I do not like the way God deals with you and with me most of the time. But I don't like it because I want the smooth, wide, easy road that leads to destruction. And God loves you and me enough that He allows all of these things. And what the Scripture says that He does, so that you are very clear, is that He puts you in this thing called a crucible. Little pot. And He puts you inside of it. And He comes over here to that Bunsen burner, y'all remember from science class. And He lights it and He turns that up until the flame turns blue and almost disappears. And there's a heat under that crucible so severe that that metal, that precious metal, begins to melt. Brothers and sisters, He is turning up the heat on so many of you right now. But it's not because He doesn't love you. It is not because He's mean. It is because when He turns that up so high and it begins to melt, that what ends up happening is the sin that lives in you and in me floats to the top and He scrapes it off. And what is left is pure and precious and valuable beyond all measure. You don't want the hard road and I don't want the hard road. But what's left on the other side is so beautiful. And here's the part that you might just miss. Is that when He takes you out of that crucible, it says that He puts you in the palm of His hand. And He says, brothers and sisters, nothing will separate you. But this is the beauty. Father, it's the best thing I could ever give you. Right here. You are the gift that Jesus gives to the Father. Go look at who you are and think that you're ready to be the gift. You're not. So it is the blessing, mercy, and kindness of God that He turns up that crucible, because He wants all of you and He wants to present you a pure and spotless bride. So He's taking all the dross off. Well, I sure want to be that other side. Can you trust Him as He turns up the heat? See, Jesus has given the last three sermons leading up to this, proving that He's exactly who He claims, the Savior of the world. These now who claim to be chasing after Him are influenced by ones who have already rejected Jesus. And as a result of questionable influence, as a result of hard hearts, as a result of hard truth, they reject the offer of salvation of Jesus. And we'll see it each week over the next couple weeks as it ramps up a little more and a little more. Jesus says that He alone is the answer to this world, to the answer of sin and death. But people don't want Jesus because He's not bringing them comfort. He's not bringing them ease in this world. What Jesus does bring, it's a call to death. The death to self. The death to sin. A change of nature and a change of will. And we have confidence to allow that changes in us. Because Jesus is not only Savior, but He's Lord. And that means that you and I were bought with a price. And the price is His body beaten and His blood shed because of the sin that lives in you and me. You see, repentance is necessary, not just to salvation, but in the ongoing relationship. If you have done what the Bible says not to do, If you have not done what the Bible says to do, Scripture very clearly calls it sin. And what is necessary for us is to confess before God and to give it to Him and say, I turn from it and I receive your way. Help me to walk in it. And you're going to find that you're going to make all sorts of claims and redouble efforts and try a little harder, but it will never work. The only thing that will ever work is to press into your relationship with Jesus. God, whatever it takes, you can have it. Just walk with me through it. And so I invite you to come and surrender, to join, to give your everything. Whatever is necessary, you respond as God is calling you. Father in heaven, we have a brief moment in a service to ask you to forgive us, to receive you as Lord and Savior. Some of us are asking even now for you to forgive us of the sin that's in our life. God, how easy it is to have anger. How easy it is to have anxiety. We've even talked as we have a Sunday school class looking at those quote, little sins that we just allow to rage in us because they seem to be common. And yet you want all of it. Father, I know that I have held things back because I just don't see it as a big deal. I pray that you would let us see that every sin is a big deal. That you will have all authority and power. That we will be your children. That we will truly, truly hunger for what does it mean to be a disciple. God, I pray that you'll have your way in us right now. That we will faith you enough to respond. Bless us, Holy Spirit. And overcome our weakness, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to stand and sing. You have an opportunity to respond. If you need prayer, you can come down and just lay on your face before the Lord symbolically and come talk to me. I'll pray with you. Maybe you need to join the church. Maybe you need to be baptized. However the Lord is leading you, respond. Don't lose the moment. The opportunity to continue our worship as we give to the Lord, recognizing that He has given us everything. Is He even trustworthy of our finances? Does He know your finances even in the hard times and when governments make decisions? Does He know your finances in inflation? Does He have your heart? Father in heaven, let this be an act of worship that we show our faith and trust in you, that you show us where our faith and trust is. That we might give out of an overflow of our heart. That this that is taken is used for building up the saints. For going out and sharing so that others might come and become saints with us. As we worship, let us continue to worship you in spirit and truth, we pray. Amen. I'm going to invite you to come down. We're going to partake of the Lord's meal, and I'm just going to share quickly with us this morning. You taught on this just a couple months ago, and I want to share with you what we know is that when we are baptized, it is telling the world that we belong to Jesus. And it's our public profession of faith. But you know, there's a lot of people that question. They say, well, maybe Jesus already came back. Maybe we missed it. Can we still hope in him? And one of the things that Jesus was prepared for before he ever ascended into heaven is he said, people are going to question how long I'm gone. He said, what I'm going to do is I'm going to set this meal. And see, this wasn't plan B, because this happened at the Passover. This was already planned from the foundations of the world. And so he said, what I'm going to do is I'm going to have you, as regularly, as often as you do this, you're going to do it to remember me, because I am faithful. And I am coming back, and I will get you, and on the last day I will raise you up. Fear not. And so we're going to have this meal, and if you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you have already made that public profession of baptism, then we're going to invite you to join with us. If you have not, I'm going to ask you to just let it pass, because the Bible says that those who are taking this in an unworthy manner, not only because they do not believe, but also because you're not ready to take it, because you have issues within the family, that it's better for you not to take it, because you might get sick and you might die. And while a believer is going to spend eternity with God, that's not the choice that he would have. It's a choice you might take. But he says, be very careful, because this is a weighty meal. Amen. And so I want to invite that. Now, I'm going to invite all of the children that want to come down and sit on the floor. And as we go through the Lord's Supper this morning, anybody who wants to let their children come sit down here, I'm just going to talk to the children and teach them, and you get to be participants in it this morning with us. And so, as Jesus was fulfilling the... Bob, you come hang out with me. As Jesus was fulfilling the Passover, and he becomes the Passover, he was sitting with his disciples, and he took this meal. And they don't give thanks in the Jewish culture the way we do. You know how we pray that McDonald's is somehow transformed into an edible meal that brings us nourishment and strength? What they did was said, God, everything that we have is because you have given it to us, and we praise you, the one true and living God. And so he had taken this and given thanks, and he distributed it. We'll do that now. These men are going to serve you. I think we're good. These men are going to serve you. We're going to serve them. We'll serve each other. Everybody is equal at the Lord's table. And so it's symbolic of that. So we'll all sit down, because we're at rest in the midst of whatever is out there, because Jesus is our Lord and Savior. So we'll pass this out and then we'll pray. If you are a young person, parents, if you want, you can just send the children down here. If you don't want to, that's fine. But if you want them, I'm going to talk with them about what the Lord's Supper is.
Your body crucified.
what we're doing right now, is we're remembering that at this moment, that sin costs everything. Sin costs our life. Sin is a big deal. And Jesus said that he loved us so much that he wasn't going to make us pay the consequences if we'd have faith and trust him. The scriptures told us that the kind of Savior that we needed wasn't the kind of a Savior that would just be a king and change things for us right now, but a Savior that would change things for all eternity. So God had planned all the way back in the Old Testament. God actually planned before the foundations of the world that the kind of Savior that we needed was going to have his body that was going to be broken. And it was beaten. And it was treated terribly. Jesus was treated terribly. They spit on him. They pulled the beard out of his face. And they twisted vines that they made a fake crown and they pushed it down and it pierced into his skull. And then they had him walk in front of everybody, and they made him walk naked in front of everybody. They beat him in his back until it was bloody. And that's because of the consequence of sin. Not just my sin, but our sin. And then the scripture told us that that's what was going to have to happen to his body, because that's the consequence of sin. So he said, I want you to remember the consequence of sin. Because we have to choose whether we're going to follow Jesus or whether we're going to follow what we want. So in that meal, as he sat, he said, my body's going to be broken. His disciples didn't even understand that at the time. And so Jesus was going to have to go to the cross to pay for the consequence. I hope that you desire to want to eat this meal. If you do, that means you desire that Jesus would be your Lord and Savior. And so in that meal, he said, there's going to be a season to come. You're going to be weary. And you're going to think that maybe you missed something. It's too late. He says, I want you to know that I'm faithful. Though it might seem like a long time for you, I'm coming back. And so he took the bread and holding it up to heaven, said, God, you are good. This is Jesus' body, and it's given because of our sin. And so we think about it, and we can hold it. Take the opportunity to remember all of what he has done for us and all the sins that he has forgiven us of. We say, God, thank you. Thank you that you love me enough to send your one and only Son for me. Joyfully receive all that you've given me, knowing that you are the bread of life. Therefore, I partake. And I'm unashamed to let everybody know that I belong to you. And I take this meal to remind me that you are faithful. So after giving thanks, he said, take this and eat it. The meal wasn't over. He had more to do and more to talk about. These men again will continue to serve you.
Remember.
do want to also tell you is the reason that we can sit down right here. And you know, the Bible is very interesting. The Bible tells us about prayer. It says that every form in prayer says laying flat. It says standing up, kneeling. And you're working, you can pray. The Bible doesn't ever tell you to sit down to pray. But the Bible does tell you that they sat and they reclined. And they were so relaxed when they had this meal. And all the while knowing that what waited outside that door was the death of Jesus. And so no matter what is going on out in the world around us, no matter how bad life is, we can rest and we can sit at peace, because no matter what we're walking through, no matter what we're going through, Jesus is still Lord. He's still on the throne and he's still in control of the wind and the waves. And so what then happened was, going all the way back to the Passover, see, Jesus, God was bringing a judgment. It's a judgment as a result of sin, and the death angel came all the way back when they were in Egypt. And if you believed and you had faith in Jesus, then you put the blood of a lamb outside your door. And when that death angel came, the death angel said, oh, that person believes in God, and he passed by. But those who didn't trust, those who didn't believe that God was faithful, the firstborn male of every house died. And he said, if you will faith Jesus, then you'll take this juice that's representative of the blood, and you're going to cover yourself in it by drinking it. And in that faith, we then don't have to worry about the sin that we've committed. Not because it's not there, it's because Jesus has paid the consequence of it. And the Bible says that without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness of sin. And so then at the end of our life, we are left to know who's going to pay for the consequences of the sins that we've done. Do we want to pay for our own consequences? What do you guys think? When you do bad things, do you want to pay those consequences? You're like getting a SWAT or a timeout? Levi likes getting those, by the way. We don't want to pay the consequences, but somebody has to pay the consequence. Either we pay it or Jesus pays it. And so he said that his blood was going to be shed for the forgiveness of sin for all those who believe and have faith. So we believe that Jesus is exactly who he said. He's done exactly what he said he will do, and he will forgive your sin and mine. So he took the cup, and after saying, God, you are so good, you paid the consequence for the sin that I owe, that we owe. We drink this because we want to identify as yours, and we want the whole world to know that we belong to you. Thank you for paying the consequence of my sin. And after giving thanks, he said, take this, all of you who believe, and drink it. You guys did a great job. Go back to your mom and dad. Brothers and sisters and friends, I want to just share in such a way that hopefully children can understand. We've been blessed as we walked our children through that they desire to love, honor, and fear the Lord. And they're working toward that end. But we have to come to Jesus, all of us, like little children, to believe and to trust. So this morning we're going to end our service. That doesn't mean that God is ending his call to you. Have questions, I'll be here, Jeff will be here, these men. Look, you got to just know if God will use these fellas, he'll use anybody. Maybe he's calling you. But just because we end our service doesn't mean that your time has to be over. Come and see us. We'd love to pray for you. They'd love to pray for you. We'll answer any question that we can. As we go out today, I hope that you don't just close the book and say you're done with God until next week. keep wrestling. What does it mean to be a disciple? Does Jesus have all of you? And if he's turning up that crucible of faith, is he trustworthy?
Yes, he is.
We'll pray and be dismissed this morning as you lead us in one more song. Okay. Father, not sure what else to say, but thank you. Thank you that you love us enough to turn up the heat. But thank you that you love us enough that you are in the fire with us. Thank you that as your children, even though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we don't need to fear any evil because you are with us. Your rod and your staff, they correct us and protect us. You lay a banquet before us as we sit reclined, even in the presence of our enemies. Father, as we stand and sing together, a message of unity, a message of hope that we have in you, I pray that you will answer every one of your children where they are. Remind them that you are in control. And everyone that is wrestling with whether you're trustworthy or not, that today will still be the day of salvation. They will not leave here until they have done business with you. But let our light shine in such a way that more want to come to you. Pray in Jesus' name. So after they finished their meal, they sang together. And this team is going to give their effort to have us stand one with another. Just sing and declare our hope and faith in God.
I'd invite you to stand with me. He's been so, so good to us. Let's sing that together. You've been so good, good, good to me.
To think where I would be if not.
Lord, thank you that you have promised us so much. I thank you most of all that the bread of God is he who came down from heaven to give us life, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, that you're working and moving in each of our lives. And Father, if there's anybody in this room right now that has not come to that place where they realize that they're standing before a sovereign God that requires a righteousness that we can't have on our own, that right now that you would bring him to the point of repentance, because repentance is required. We know that we fall short of your glory. I pray right now, Lord, that person that you're speaking to that's in that position would place their faith and trust in what Christ did on the cross, the finished work, and that they can enjoy the times of refreshing that come from that, that they can be made alive in the life giver, the bread of life, Jesus Christ. Thank you for your word this morning, how it spoke to me, and I know so many in this room. Pray that you'll keep speaking to us as we separate now and we go our separate ways. Help us to just reflect on what you shared and you've revealed to us today. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for worshiping together. You are dismissed. Anything you want.